Praise the Lord again. Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. Amen. Amen. We want to officially welcome you to the Pavilion of Praise Network. Amen. We pray that something is going to be said and done on this afternoon that will be a blessing unto you. Amen. We're getting ready to hear the word of the Lord. Amen. She's no stranger to us. Amen. She is the woman that God has chosen to birth me into this world almost 40 years ago. Praise the name of Jesus. Amen. And so I am grateful and I am thankful for this mighty woman of God that's getting ready to come and to grace this sacred desk. Amen. At this time, just before she gets ready to come, amen, we're going to ask, amen, Evangelist Thornton, don't say that, baby. Amen. We're going to ask Evangelist Thornton to come, and she's going to give us, amen, a piece of a song, amen, and then the next voice you will hear behind this desk will be none other than Mother District Missionary Frances King Coulter. Let's celebrate them as they come at this time.
Yeah. this opportunity. This is a twofold message. This will be shown in the New Jersey Jurisdiction's Women Convention. The theme is, Yet Will I Praise Him.
Yes. You hit him up.
I'd like to give thanks to my Bishop John Mark Richardson and his lovely wife. I would like to give thanks to Supervisor D. Antoinette Robertson.
Amen.
I would like to give thanks to my pastor, Quentin E. Coulter,
Amen.
And my First Lady, Roshan Renee Coulter. I ask that you pray for me. They could have gotten anybody to bring the word, but they asked me to. And so, therefore, I'm going to do the best that I can with the help of the Lord. I thank Sister Thornton for that song, but I want to sing a little snippet of this. Hallelujah, anyhow. Never ever let the devil get you down. When my trouble comes your way, hold your head up high and say, Hallelujah, anyhow. Oh, Hallelujah, anyhow. Never let your troubles get you down. He is an example of faithfulness as he loses everything. important to him, yet he remained faithful to God. The purpose of Job is to illustrate God's sovereignty and faithfulness during the time of suffering. In chapters 1 through 3, God tests Job's faithfulness through allowing Satan to attack him. God told Satan, "Behold, all that he has is in your power. Only do not put forth your hand on him." Through Job's trials, all his loss, including his health, his wife even telling him to curse God and commit suicide, but it remains strong and faithful. Through all this, Job did not sin nor blame God foolishly. Chapters 4 through 37, Job's friends gave him plenty of advice. They accused him falsely of being in sin, was the reason why he was going through what he was going through, not because God was trying to grow me. In chapters 38 and 42, God speaks to Job and restores him, knows that Job had received incorrect guidance from his friends. He was made to humble himself and pray for his friends in order to be for them to be forgiven. And then God gave him double for his trouble. As saints of God, when things begin to happen to us, we begin to question why. We look at ourselves and we examine ourselves. Have I sinned? Is God angry with me? What do I need to do to turn these things around? Job even went as far as to curse the day he was conceived and the day he was born. But he stayed faithful and true to the living God. God uses suffering for his own purposes, for several reasons, but he never wastes suffering. He don't waste it. It's for a purpose. He allowed Satan to use his own tactics for his purpose to be fulfilled. One, it could be to bring glory to himself. Sometimes the Lord may say, "I got a good worker. Sister Thornton is faithful." And then he'll put her on exhibition so that we can see what it looks like to go through trials and tribulations. But he only puts those on exhibit that he knows ain't gonna get in. He knew Job's character because he told you what he thought about Job. He was upright. He eschewed evil. He was a good man. He was a man of faith. Sometimes it may be to show his power, how he can uphold you. God is all powerful. There's nothing that he can't do. He may also use this to develop you and bring you to an expected end. He may also use it to expose secret sin that is doing the damage to you. Maybe to increase your faith, for you to enter into the fellowship of his suffering. Nobody's, I don't care how bad you suffer, ain't nobody suffer like you. Ain't nobody nailed your feet to the cross. Ain't nobody put those spikes in your hand. Ain't nobody hooked you to your back plan. Ain't nobody pushed you in your side. So maybe he wants you to what suffering is like. Maybe it's to humble you. Because he told Paul, and he put a thorn in Paul's face.
that he might not get the big head. Because you know, sometimes when God uses us in a mighty way, we think we all of that in a bag of chips too. So he has to put a thorn in our flesh to keep us humble and keep us looking to him. Maybe it's to test your earnestness. Maybe it's to help you understand the plan of salvation. Or maybe it's to awaken you out of your lost condition. Because some folks in the church are not saved. But they think they're saved because they come to church. So he has to allow some things to happen to get your attention. Now, I'm going to tell you some personal experience. I've been through so many health issues. And it started at the age of 30, and I'm now 70. I have had approximately 34 surgeries between that lifespan. I have prayed to God for healing. And here's what gets me. I have prayed for others, and they've been healed. And I asked God, I'm seeking your face like never before. Why won't you hear me? Heal me. And I get nothing. I hear no response. I know I'm healed by his stripes because the word said so. But the manifestation of healing has not happened yet. Y'all don't know when it happens because I'll be totally responsible. But he always encourages me through his word. One time when I was about to give up, the Lord gave me a vision. And when you plant a tree, and when the tree is a sapling and it's little, it needs support of some sort. And so you put some sticks in the ground and then tie the tree to the stick so that when the wind blows, you know, it won't uproot because it's not rooted deeply yet.
That's right.
But as time goes on and the rain comes and the wind blows and the sun shines and you go through many different things, the tree roots get deeper and they go deeper. When it's a dry season, they go even deeper. And the Lord told me one phrase. Bend, but don't break. Hallelujah. He dropped that in my spirit, and that phrase has sustained me on many a day. My marriage was in trouble, and I didn't even know it. And God sent another vision. And it's funny what God was seeing. He will send what is familiar to you. So he gave me a vision of my favorite show on TV, Let's Make a Deal. There were three doors. You know how Let's Make a Deal operates. And I went to door number one, and the door opened, and I began to fall. And he asked me, will you stand? Not knowing why he asked me, I said yes. Went to door number two, same thing happened. Went to door number three, same thing happened, except this time, he caught me in his arms. I remember it like it was yesterday. I felt the love of God all encamped around about me. I felt safe. And he asked me again, will you stand? And I told him, yes, I'll stand. And he said, yeah, you will stand because I'm going to help you to stand.
Yes, Lord.
The very next day, I found that my husband was seeing another woman. will of God. It's your will for me to suffer. I say yes, God. And I won't praise you. Thank you. Strengthen you. Yeah. Promises are
Come on, water, water, shark.
Thank you.